The summary. Okay, let me got it. Okay, so the summary or the conclusion rather of the talk should be that like one basic negative statement and a positive statement. And the negative statement is that, well, it's just not sufficient to keep on speaking about entropy versus energy balances or entropy and entropy production principles to describe response and fluctuations, say, non-perturbatively around equilibrium. It just doesn't work. And there are good reasons for that. And there should be a complement there. And that is what I will be using as for the word frenzy. And that's also what I would like to explain, that things like accessibility of a condition, which is a comparing of states, will be important both for relaxation to equilibrium. So in that sense, input to Boltzmann's explanation of irreversibility, but also for steady state features of steady state non-equilibrium. All right, so let's start, however, as I promised, with equilibrium. And you know, in equilibrium, there's really some kind of a strange, miraculous degeneracy. Somewhat exaggerating, perhaps, one could say that there is an essentially unique entropy. We can also call it more generally thermodynamic potentials, but let's call it entropy. And what is so miraculous is that the same entropy, basically the same entropy, is governing quite distinct aspects of our equilibrium statistical mechanics. You know, it started with heat, as we have the Clausius heat theorem in 1860-65 there, where entropy is related to the reversible heat over temperature. At the same time, so 20 years later, Boltzmann and Planck and Einstein emphasized the relation between that Clausius entropy and fluctuation. So it got like a more microscopic or mesoscopic understanding, counting microstates corresponding to a macroscopic condition. And it was a very useful step, of course, to understand how things like free energy and entropy and heat and work also take their place in fluctuations to understand the probability of something. That's not enough. Even that same entropy appears as a Lyapunov function, for example, in the Boltzmann H theorem, in the Boltzmann equation for dilute gases. It gives you the arrow of time. And that's not enough yet. Still, we have the same entropy which enters in the word dissipation for the fluctuation dissipation theorem in the classical Kubo linear response regime. Again, it's a kind of unexpected that the response is governed truly by, again, the excess entropy given by the perturbation, the same entropy, as also finally in my list appears in Onsager's theory, where we have the so-called entropic forces appearing, or the thermodynamic forces, which are really statistical forces, if we understand them more mesoscopically, but they are governed again by, you know, gradients of entropy, gradients of free energy, which determine how the relaxation and all of that and currents will flow. So that miracle we should not expect in non-equilibrium. Anyway, before we leave equilibrium, I have here your suggestion for your new t-shirt. Sometimes you see t-shirts with Lagrangian and Maxwell equations, I think, for equilibrium statistical mechanics. A t-shirt with this formula going from Clausius, Boltzmann, Kubo, Onsager would make a nice summary of a course in equilibrium statistical mechanics. Just to understand all these formula is, I think, a full-term course in equilibrium statistical mechanics. I will not explain that, of course, I'm not giving a course, but I will just say two things which are maybe less known, and that is that thermodynamic interpretation of the Kubo formula. You know, the Kubo formula, and I use this formula for the range of classical linear response theory formulas that appeared in the 50s, 60s, they were really done in a kind of quantum mood. They were really done in the sense of you do perturbation theory on operators. If you look at the original papers, they are almost first you do the quantum response before you do the classical response. But there are other ways of doing that. And I write here in this box, the classical Kubo formula, where I look at, I'm not sure whether you see my cursor. Do you see my cursor?
Yes, yeah, we do.
Okay, so we have an observable, that's O of T, and we are making a perturbation by adding to the Hamiltonian, to the energy, we're adding a time-dependent perturbation where the amplitude is H of S at time S, and the potential is V of S. And then the change of the observation, so the expectation of O at time T, from the perturbed to the unperturbed at time t is given by this Kubo formula. Now, that formula probably you recognize. So this is an expectation of a correlation function in the unperturbed equilibrium dynamics. But you can rewrite this formula via simple perturbation as really an expectation where the observable O is correlated with nothing else than the entropy flux due to the perturbation. So you have here the change of energy that you see and also the work done. And that is divided by temperature over KB. And in other words, you get that this Kubo formula is really an observation, it's really a correlation, excuse me, between observable and an entropy flux. So in that sense, even linear response is in fact entropic when you do it around equilibrium. Another final thing about equilibrium is that what I said that about Onsager, really, I mean, even when people discuss some aspects of chemistry, biology, biophysics, they really often use the so-called irreversible thermodynamics where you work with local equilibria and where you really understand what is happening in terms of reactions and relaxation processes in terms of, you know, this kind of tobogan, where the landscape is made by free energy or by entropy. You know, some thermodynamic potential, the Gibbs free energy, for example, defines a landscape in your kind of collective coordinate space. And then whatever happens, you describe by basically gradient dynamics. This is the so-called gradient dynamics for discussing the behavior around equilibrium. Well, that is, of course, going back to a long time, to the times indeed of Gibbs and Onsager, but all of that will no longer hold. You cannot expect that this unique river of entropy, which can be called heat or can be called force, that this unique river of entropy would not split in little streams when you go up the hill, and that hill is called non-equilibrium. So let us now move to close to equilibrium, which is somehow the neighbor of equilibrium. And let us first look at a paper of MacLennan of 59, so that's quite some time ago already, more than 60 years, where he's discussing the statistical mechanics of the steady state. He was not alone in that time, of course, but he is somehow known for the so-called MacLennan ensembles. Maybe also know that under the title of MacLennan-Zubarev ensemble. It's not very well known, but what it is doing is something.
Can I interrupt you? Of course. With a question?
Of course.
So, I mean, it's related with the previous discussion, previous slides. So, yeah. You were. So, in your previous slides, the title was. You were discussing like for equilibrium, but then you were discussing Kubo formulas and change of entropy.
I understand.
And now you're switching to something that you are called close to equilibrium. So
yes, I understand. So indeed, there is a possible confusion in my terminology here. So I say we are in equilibrium and I discuss linear response. So here I mean the linear regime around equilibrium and how you return to equilibrium. Somehow it is about the stability of equilibrium. So the stability of equilibrium is, of course, a dynamical question. And in that sense, you move around equilibrium. So in the way that you're not strictly in equilibrium, but you're moving around equilibrium. So in that sense, it is confusing. When I say close to equilibrium here in that slide, I do not mean a dynamical kind of time evolution around equilibrium, but I mean steady state, which is not equilibrium, which is stationary, but not equilibrium, and which I consider as is such, not in a it's not time dependent. It's a steady state, but it's a steady state which is obtained, for example, because I have in a metal bar two temperatures, left and right, which are only very little different. Or I have non-conservative forces in a system, but the amplitude of the non-conservative forces is minute, like in an Navier-Stokes setup, but with a driving force, which is really vanishing amplitude, very small amplitude. And I'm interested in understanding what is the steady state statistics. I'm interested in the fluctuations in that steady state. So that it's close to equilibrium, but not in a dynamical sense. It's really, you know, we want to understand the steady state, the static fluctuations for an invariant distribution for some dynamics, which moves close to, maybe a better word would be, in fact, close to detail balance. Does that help?
Yeah, yeah, it's clear. It's clear to me now. So,
but thank you for your question. It's really clarifying, clarifying question, because, you know, close to equilibrium is a, maybe I should also add, especially if there are mathematicians around, that when I use equilibrium, I always remain, it's not just stationary. Equilibrium means really something where you have an underlying time reversibility. So where you have detailed balance dynamics for which the equilibrium ensemble is reversible. When I'm speaking about close to equilibrium in the sense of MacLennan, it means that I am really static, steady state, stationary, but not detailed balance. Detailed balance is broken, is violated, just a little bit. Okay, so what MacLennan is doing is to give, just like Gibbs was giving the ensembles in equilibrium, MacLennan was specifying the ensembles close to equilibrium. And it's not so well known, but there is an explicit ensemble, so-called MacLennan ensemble.
Sorry, can I have another, like, maybe
of course, general question? Of course, please.
So in the spirit, it seems that to what you are doing somehow resembles kinetic theory. So is it something similar or?
No. Yes and no, yes and no. Of course, again, you can do kinetic theory to understand approaches to equilibrium. I mean, if you call the, if you look at the Boltzmann equation for dilute gas, you can call this kinetic theory, right?
Yes.
This is not what I'm doing with MacLennan. Again, I have a dynamics which breaks detailed balance. So we will not have time reversibility. Okay. And we are in the steady state. So I'm not even, I mean, the MacLennan ensemble, what is great about the MacLennan ensemble is that you don't need to know the dynamics. Just like for the Gibbs distributions, nobody asks you when you're doing equilibrium statistical mechanics, or at least, okay, maybe not, people are not necessarily going to ask you when you're doing equilibrium statistical mechanics, what is the dynamics? You just start by the central object, which is the energy or the Hamiltonian. You have the temperature, maybe the chemical potential, what have you, and you just write down the ensembles. What MacLennan was doing is to consider a situation where, again, there is no need to specify the details of the dynamics, but having in mind a frustration which is related to a non-homogeneous temperature, non-homogeneous chemical potential, or small rotational forces. And again, he's writing down the ensemble corresponding to that, describing the static fluctuations. Does it make sense?
Yeah, so then what is like the goal of this formalism kind of?
If you know the static fluctuation, you can start to compute. Just like in the Gibbs ensemble, you can start to compute expectations of things. I mean, and in fact, the MacLennan ensembles, you can connect to the kinetic theory around equilibrium, because if you know the static fluctuations, you also know a lot of the response theory around equilibrium. I mean, in that sense, it's connected, of course. But it's kind of, you know, it's a dream of many people to understand what, how to describe, how to characterize the nature of the steady state of the static fluctuations, which are not in equilibrium. So in other words, I repeat, take your favorite non-equilibrium system, which is maybe because there is a driving in temperature or chemical potential or chemical driving. And you know, to know, you know, what's the probability of seeing a particular density in position? What is the probability to see a particular fluctuation in kinetic energy? You can ask these things, just like you can ask them in kinetic. You can ask about what is the specific heat. You can ask all the same questions, but you're not in equilibrium.
Thank you.
It seems that
maybe,
this is
Yes. Want to interrupt, and even maybe to clarify, because I don't know, most of people maybe are not doing this research in this field. So like, even you are not going to equilibrium. I mean, there is no, sometimes you will never reach this equilibrium. I think that maybe this is the confusion, because you think when you are talking about kinetic theory that in the end you have some equilibrium, but it's not the, I mean, not necessarily. If you don't have detailed balance, you may not have this micro reversibility in your system, and then you are not going to any equilibrium. We are just going to stationary state.
And so it probably means that I am not giving enough examples, no? But indeed, like if you're doing biophysics or anything which is driven like turbulence or what have you, you see it's really a matter of time scales. When I have a metal bar which is connected to two heat baths, a cold and a hot one, then I have in mind that I keep the hot and the cold reservoir at constant temperature so that I reach a steady condition in my metal bar where there will be an energy current. This metal bar, of course, if I would leave it forever, it would make relaxation to equilibrium and the hot will get colder and the cold will get hotter. But this I'm not doing. I keep the cold cold and I keep the hot hot at the different temperatures. And I'm interested in that time scale where I look at the metal bar in its steady state. And I want to understand in that metal bar, how can I characterize fluctuations in density, kinetic energy, what have you? That's what I want to do. And close to equilibrium means that the temperatures of the at the ends of the metal bar, that they are not very different. Okay? I hope that clarifies it. It's important. It's very important for the rest because what I will be going in if I go farther and farther away from equilibrium. So you have to understand that that may be relevant for our world. In fact, I would say non-equilibrium and far from equilibrium are far more relevant than equilibrium for many purposes, from both astrophysics to nanoscience. It's full of steady non-equilibria where currents are maintained, steady currents are maintained, and not at all you see Maxwell-Boltzmann distributions, but you see deviations from that. And if you're close to equilibrium, that are described by the MacLennan and Zubarev ensembles. Okay?
Oh, okay. Another maybe related question. So then let's say I can guess what is the distribution in kinetic theory for this type of situation. Then in principle, I can connect the MacLennan Zubarev to the kinetic theory, but it's just difficult. That's the message.
Well, I mean, kinetic theory is mostly about, I don't know, kinetic theory is can be about transport coefficients to get characterization of viscosity, diffusion, etc., relation between them, or relaxation to equilibrium. That's typically the what we call the old kinetic theory, somewhat before statistical mechanics came off the ground. Here again, if I speak about MacLennan, it is related to that, but it is not the same. First of all, this MacLennan theory is certainly not restricted to dilute systems or to gases. It's a general formalism, just like the Gibbs distribution or the Gibbs statistical mechanics is a general formalism. That's already an important difference. All right? And, yes. And it's, I mean, it's not very well known. And you could say, well, maybe there is a reason why it is not very well known. Because it's not very useful. And in fact, it's true that for many dynamical questions around equilibrium, you can use linear response. This MacLennan is somehow, well, it's mostly used in quantum statistical mechanics, actually, where you would like to describe in a kind of formal way what would be the distribution, say, of occupations when you have in a regime which is the Coulomb blockade regime or so in solid state physics. But it's not the same as kinetic theory. While there are relations, it goes beyond it, much beyond it. All right?
Okay.
So what I wanted to say about this MacLennan ensemble is that, you know, this is like linear order around equilibrium, where linear order is in the parameter which breaks detailed balance. What parameter can it be? Well, it could be that, suppose I have particles which are supposed to move on a ring. So they are trapped in a ring. I can, suppose they are charged, I can put an EMF so that they are driven. These colloids, for example, in a viscous medium, they are driven around the ring. But if this electric field or if this EMF is small, I can speak about the steady behavior of these particles, these colloids in the ring, and that will be given by the MacLennan ensemble. Now, what is specific about the MacLennan ensemble is that it's not that you need to know much about the dynamics. What you need to know is some part of the entropy flux, the so-called irreversible part of the entropy flux. I'm not going to give the details here what exactly it is, but I wanted to say, and that's the main message, that even when you're having, you know, when you're close to a detailed balance in the sense that you perhaps only have a very small electric field, then you're still very much in the spirit of equilibrium, namely, basically energy and entropy suffice to characterize the fluctuations. I didn't give you the mathematical formulation of that. I could do, but I also have a reference here in Journal of Mathematical Physics, where you see exactly how that Maclaurin ensemble arises, but with the message that it is working basically on the same level as equilibrium, but instead of somehow static entropy, you have to look at entropy production, but it's thermodynamic in nature, basically. It has a lot of thermodynamics in its characterization of the fluctuation. That's the message I wanted to say about Maclennan. In fact, there is another, there is another characterization close to equilibrium, which was, which is called the minimum entropy production principle. It has been formulated in linearly reversible thermodynamics first by my famous compatriot Prigozhin, 70 years ago, basically, or 60 years ago. And it has been extended in many directions. In fact, it has also been extended into a maximum entropy production principle. It can also be presented as a least dissipation principle, as in Onsager. But at any rate, it gives you another characterization of the close to detailed balance regime in terms of, again, an entropy production principle. So just like you have a Gibbs variational principle, you know, the famous Gibbs variational principle to understand whether you have liquid water or vapor at certain temperature and pressure, this entropy production principle gives you a variational principle close to equilibrium, not in terms of free energy, but in terms of a kind of entropy production. So basically the same thermodynamic context remains. Of course, there is a kind of dynamical aspect in it because it's about entropy production rate, but the structure of variational principle in the same spirit as the Gibbs variational principle is present there. But it only works, I repeat, it only works in the linear regime around detailed balance. So a linear regime to be understood that the driving parameter, like the electric field for the colloids which are in this ring, that this electric field would be small. Is that okay? Can I leave close to detailed balance?
Yeah, I think so.
All right. I hope you're still with me, because now the next step and the talk will start with far from equilibrium. What if you go non-perturbatively? So here I want to go back to a paper of 1975, and I see that the copy in the picture was not very sharp, but this is a paper by Landauer, and there he writes about the inadequacy of entropy and entropy derivatives in characterizing the steady state. So note, the steady state means time invariant, but not reversible. There is a breaking of time reversal invariance. It's a steady state where there are currents are maintained, there is transport which is maintained. So in the time scale you're considering, it's a non-equilibrium steady state. And there in 75, Landauer writes a paper in Physical Review saying, look, all these things about entropy and even entropy production, it just can never work to characterize the steady state. And I hope you can read it, but there is a conclusion that he illustrates with an example he got with his colleague, Charlie Bennett. It's of course a bit of an anecdote, but he writes it in the paper as a conclusion. He says that, suppose I have some planetary condition and I have to understand how plausible, excuse me, you have to understand how plausible life is. So you have to compare the lifeless state, the steady state without life, and the biological state with life. And then Landauer and Bennett emphasize, we must consider the transitions between these states. Furthermore, we must take into account fluctuations. So transitions and fluctuations. So, I mean, this is, if you just look at that, it doesn't seem like a big deal. I mean, it's very natural, and in fact it is, but you have to understand that it's not quite what you do in equilibrium. In equilibrium, when you want to say what condition of the density or the profile of kinetic energy is typical, you just look at what has the largest entropy, and that's a state function. The phase volume decides whether you have a big phase volume in a closed microscopic mechanical system that determines what is the most plausible. Equilibrium is most typical and is the most boring state, of course. But when you're going in an open system with possible non-equilibrium effects, then what Landauer is saying, on the one hand, entropy and entropy derivatives don't work, and it feels like you must consider transitions. And so what we have been doing is to make that precise and explicit. What kind of transitions, what kind of fluctuations do you need to consider for understanding plausibilities of states, and what can you do with that? All right? And of course, it's true what Landauer was saying, that in entropy and its derivatives are inadequate, in meaning in the sense not sufficient. But of course, there must be a positive message, and the positive message is that nevertheless, we can do something. All right. So in that sense, we give a bit of a frenzy, will be a kind of constructive continuation of this Landauer program. But let me start with the heuristics. If you remember the great, I mean, one of the greatest successes of physics is the Boltzmann picture of relaxation to equilibrium for a macroscopic system. And there you make a partition of the phase space basically in terms of the various possible macroscopic conditions. And equilibrium, that's somehow the biggest phase space volume. And the other are very small. And you compare phase space volumes, as I was saying before, to see what is most plausible. Now, the relaxation for Boltzmann is really connected with the size of the phase space volumes. Now, what I am saying, or what we are saying, is that this word frenzy will be related to more aspects of boundaries, because even when you have a small room, like the pink room here, it depends whether there are windows and doors and how many there are to go out. It depends on how much time you can spend. I mean, how much free pathway you have in that. I'm speaking in a picture. No, it's not precise what I'm saying. But I let you on a heuristic level understand that entropy corresponds to volume of phase space volumes, while this frenzy, which we will need far from equilibrium, corresponds to the boundaries. And boundaries in the sense of how easy it is to get out, and how, when you get out, is it easy to, what is the exit and the entrance dynamics? So I'm also reminded here of, I'm also reminded here of a letter of Max Planck, where he's bringing up already so many years ago and the end of the 19th century, a similar thought. He said, in a response somehow to talks by Boltzmann, he says, well, look, I mean, probability calculus in the sense of, you know, phase space volumes, you can certainly, that's enough to determine the state of the most probable one, equilibrium. But it cannot serve, I'm reading the citation, to compute the following state that is determined not by phase space volume, but by mechanics. In other words, kinetics, as we would say, will be important far from equilibrium, certainly, to add to phase space volumes to understand this exit and entrance dynamics from phase space regions. Because if you want to understand things like jamming, localization, stimulated emission, and et cetera, this is important to see what currents we can generate and to select population statistics. But I repeat, this is just the heuristic picture that I would like you to keep in mind. Entropy is like volume of phase space. Frenzy is like this kind of dynamical boundary where it decides whether you're jammed or not, basically, and how easy it is to get to another phase space volume.
Okay. If I'm talking about this frenzy, is it that it's really connected with ergodicity?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
Well, I mean, because everything is in some way.
In a sense, if you are saying that it's like how long I will stay or how easy I will exit or to some.
Some volume of the space.
Yeah, it seems like by definition you are talking by.
Well, you probably what you have in mind is that it would help for ergodicity.
yeah, in a sense.
But it's not equivalent to it, right?
Well, it's not equivalent, for sure. It's not equivalent.
It goes in the heuristically, it goes in the same direction.
Yeah,
but it's not that you, I mean, it's not like, I mean, ergodicity talks about long time averages and all that.
True.
And
that's
even
true.
Ergodicity doesn't talk about many particle systems. You know, it's not about macroscopic systems.
Yeah, that's true.
This entropy and frenzy, they are really more on the level of macroscopic systems.
Okay.
And steady state properties, not time averages, would be also important. But it is obviously, it is.
Okay.
I mean, another point of propaganda I want to make is that, you know, that in the time of Boltzmann, there were not even, you know, the atoms, Brownian motion had still not been really understood as a sign of the atoms. So the mesoscopic level only started basically with Brownian motion. Fluctuation theory started only in the beginning of the 20th century. And then, of course, a lot of attention in lab was not on the mesoscopic level, but was still thermodynamic measurements, heat capacities. That was what one could measure. But today, in the 21st century, we can really follow trajectories. We have an enormous amount of data, and we can even analyze them. We have optical tweezers to manipulate individual particles and colloids, even on the biological level of the cells. We have extremely fast camera, fluorescence techniques, etc., to really follow the kinetics, so to speak, not just the entropy production and the heat and the work. I mean, these are the old-fashioned 20th century comments. I'm making it a bit provocative here, but in the 21st century, we should not be afraid to really speak on the level of trajectories. And that is how we get quantitative. All right, so let's see, how much time do I have left? Because now it seems that I started
you have,
a bit late. How much time?
You have 25 minutes.
Oh, okay. Good. So
well,
I want, yes?
Yeah, 20 minutes, sorry.
20 minutes, okay. So I hope I will not get too technical here, but what I wanted to tell you is that I wanted to motivate you first, that it pays, it is good to think about probabilities on trajectory. So by omega, I mean a trajectory, and it probably means between, you know, you look at the trajectory in a time window, and by trajectory, it could be one colloid or it could be more particles. It can be many things, but, you know, somehow there is a notion of that it is finite enough. And what I would like to do is to ask you to look at the probability of trajectory in terms of the probability of a trajectory of a reference ensemble. Now, this reference ensemble, that could be what you would have in equilibrium. So it could be that you understand equilibrium trajectories. That would be the probability P0 of omega. It could also be something different, but let's stick for the moment that this is like the trajectory, probability of trajectory of equilibrium systems, and you're asking such a trajectory for which I know in equilibrium its probability or its probability density, how does it change when I add, you know, driving? It means I add electric fields, magnetic fields, I add rotational forces, I add boundary conditions where I have temperature gradients, I add chemical potential difference. How does that change the probability of a trajectory of my colloids or of my fluid elements? Well, in many cases, you can relate these two via a kind of weight, which I write here as the exponential of minus A, a bit in the spirit of the usual physics, where A I call an action. So in other words, there is a way in many cases to think of the new probabilities of a trajectory in terms of the equilibrium or the old trajectory probabilities, but there is a certain action A, which of course depends on the trajectory. So if you want to make models, here we have in this box, right upper box here, that could be a piecewise constant trajectory in time where you have, say, in the vertical axis, the possible states. It could be like a random walk, continuous time random walk, which can be a model for many things. So you stay somewhere and then you jump, you wait, you jump, you wait, you jump. That would be the probability of that would be a trajectory, but it's a random trajectory because it's an open system. You have integrated out many degrees of freedom. It's really an effective description. And you get in sometimes what is called the Markov process. And you want to know the probability of this trajectory and in particular, how they differ from the standard original trajectories, probabilities before you made the perturbation, before you added the driving, etc. All right, so that is what I call talking about dynamical ensembles. Now, again, as we do in physics very often, we like to decompose the action according to symmetries. That's a very old-fashioned idea of how to speak about interactions, about actions, Lagrangians, is to decompose them in terms of their symmetries. But when I'm speaking so general and only say I'm doing non-equilibrium, there is one obvious symmetry that you want to start with, and that's time reversal symmetry. Right? So what you're doing is you're splitting up the action in two parts. One is called D, the other is S. And the difference is just that the D of omega is not changed. It's even under time reversal of the trajectory. And S is anti-symmetric under the change of under time reversal of the trajectory. So what do I mean by time reversal of the trajectory? Well, look, here you have a trajectory. You see, you can see it here. Time reversing means that instead of starting here, I start at the end and I go backward in time. That's what it means, the time reversal of the trajectory. If you would have velocities around, like in underdamped dynamics, you also have to flip the velocity, but let us not consider that here. All right, so it means that the d omega is equal to d of theta omega, where theta omega is an involution on trajectory space, where I just take the trajectory and I time reverse it. It's another trajectory. Okay, so I split up the action in a time symmetric part and a time anti-symmetric part. For some reason, there is here divide by two, but that let us leave that for the moment. Okay, so we speak about the path space measure. There is a weight A, we have an anti-symmetric S and a time symmetric part. Here is a first great thing about these dynamical ensembles, which somehow I have discovered in 1999, and that is that the S, which is the anti-symmetric part in the action, actually has a very clear physical meaning. It is the entropy flux associated to that trajectory. That's not always true, but if you have a model where you physically understand what it means, entropy and entropy fluxes to the environment, if you have a model where you have that and your model makes physical sense, then you will see that by adding the non-equilibrium, the anti-symmetric part in the action, so in other words, the part that breaks the time reversal symmetry, will be identified, can be identified with a physical entropy flux. So I'm not, this is not a definition, this is a property, okay? And of course, this is an important property because this fact that this is the entropy flux, that this is a physical quantity, has given rise to, actually, I understood this to understand something different, which was around, which are the so-called fluctuation symmetries for the entropy fluxes or the entropy production. So that was my way of understanding how these fluctuation symmetries came about. And it's a two or three line computation from here, from just this slide, to understand how you get fluctuation symmetries. Maybe I can just show you very quickly how you do that. It's really here. So you see, if I take the probability of a trajectory and I divide by the probability of the time reversed trajectory, so theta omega is the time reversed path, then because D is symmetric, you only pick up S, and that's why the two disappears. So in other words, the ratio of probabilities of the trajectory probability with respect to the time reversed trajectory probability is the exponential of the entropy flux. Now, that you can understand immediately gives rise to a lot of exciting things which have to do with the time anti-symmetric sector of the fluctuations for a non-equilibrium system. So these are immediately giving rise to all these kind of Jarzynski, Galavotti, Cohen, and what have you, local time integrated, all of these fluctuation symmetries are just a consequence of that fact, namely that S is the anti-symmetric part in the action corresponding to time reversal. But in all this theory, in all this obsession with fluctuation symmetries and entropy fluxes, people forgot that there is another letter here, and that is the D, and that is the time symmetric part of the action. And obviously, if you add driving, if you add non-equilibrium to equilibrium, it's not only that you get entropy fluxes, but you typically also generate time symmetric aspects, which are changing. And that D is what I call the frenzy. I mean, I needed something which kind of rhymes with entropy more or less, which has like to do with frequency, and sounds a bit like energy and entropy. So I chose for frenesy, which is also in the Greek, we have phrenos, which is a kind of related to the skull. And it also has a frenziness, which is a madness. Indeed, it corresponds to what we call the D of dynamical activity. So in this D of omega, these are time symmetric traffic. Somehow traffic has two components, no? That is the craziness of the traffic, which is just heavy traffic, but where there is nothing really current. And then there is the other thing, which is antisymmetric, which is the oriented traffic. Namely, you go somewhere. But D is kind of the frenziness or the frenzy indeed in the dynamical activity, which you generate by adding the non-equilibrium. All right. So having said that, we summarize that if we go to dynamical ensemble, there is a good way to separate the dissipative effects, which is in the S antisymmetric part. It's related to the force times the current you will always see in your physical models. And there is the D, which is a kind of dynamical activity, or which I call a frenzy. And it is this frenzy, we claim, that is so important when you do non-perturbative regimes around equilibrium. Somehow paradoxically, close to equilibrium and in equilibrium for response theory, you only need to care about S. You can forget about D. Somehow close to equilibrium and at equilibrium for response theory and fluctuations, you can pretend as if D does not exist. And the MacLaurin ensemble just basically takes over the S. The entropy, the minimum entropy production principle only speaks about the S. But when you're doing non-perturbative theory, then you really have to speak about the D. Like in the Lagrangian picture, the D would correspond to the kinetic energy, the S would be corresponding more to a potential energy. And what we are saying is that it is the time symmetric part which starts to play a crucial important role when you're far from time reversal symmetry. That is what we are claiming and what we can see and use as a constructive principle. Okay, so given the time that we have, maybe let me go a bit over quickly enough about simple examples to illustrate that. So a simple example would be, okay, there are many simple examples, but what you see in these pictures, I hope you see my cursor, is for example, current characteristic, a current voltage characteristic of some system. So you see the green plot here, that's a current. And the horizontal axis would be like the driving, like the electric potential or the electric field. But close to equilibrium, meaning close to E equals zero, you see the linear regime where the slope will be this, the slope will be the diffusion constant. That's the Einstein relation or the Einstein-Sutherland relation, where you have an equality between the mobility and the diffusion constant. That's the fluctuation-dissipation relation for such conductivity problems. But if you are going farther from equilibrium, you may see much more interesting life. You could see that, in fact, the harder you push here in that regime, far from equilibrium, the harder you push, it can be that the less current you get. So there is a negative differential conductivity. You can see it in simple models of particle conductivity, but you can also see it in heat conductivity. And you have to explain that. Of course, there are exactly solvable models and numerical things and what have you to understand that. But the simplest unifying understanding I got for understanding is because of the frenzy. In this regime, close to equilibrium in response theory, you only need to correlate your current with the entropy flux, which are positively correlated and related to the Kubo response formula gives you the diffusion is equal to the mobility. But when you're far from equilibrium, since the action also has this frenetic term, you can see that anti-correlations between the jamming and the current, because this is a dynamical activity, can lead to negative differential conductivity. Okay, I'm understanding that this is a bit fast, but that is where you have to look for far from equilibrium to understand. Okay, so there are some other references here. So also for thermal conductivity, the same applies. Another thing is that if you look at second order response, so non-linear response around equilibrium, you can see that it's not only the change in chemical potential which determines the response, but also the precise kinetics of how the reservoir is connected to the system will matter. And that is again picked up by the frenzy. So here we have a second order response Okay, I will not give you all the details, but although changing the chemical potential is thermodynamically, you can do in many ways, there can be kinetically different, and the frenzy will exactly pick up what kind of, how this kinetic change happens and gives you the second order response. By the way, I hope it's clear that if you know the action, you know, if you know the frenzy, by example, and you know the entropy flux, that you can do response theory, right? Because if you know the probabilities of trajectories, how they change with respect to a reference ensemble, it's clear that you can do response theory, but you will need the time symmetric sector if you're not in equilibrium. Here is a very simple example, extremely simple, about population inversion, which is biologically extremely important. So let me tell you exactly what is happening here because it's so simple. So we take a three-state Markov process. So we have three states, 1, 2, and 3. It can be gate open, gate closed, and gate in a third state. I don't know what, for a pore membrane or something. It can be protein expression, anything. But we have three possible states, and we have transition rates. So the rate, this is like a probability per unit time to go from 1 to 2, from 2 to 3, from 3 to 1. So these are the rates. And you see, I have here an epsilon. And this epsilon means that if epsilon is big, you typically go from 1 to 2, then you go from 2 to 3, and then you go from 3 to 1 because the epsilon is positive. And the other way is hard because it's minus epsilon in the exponential. But there is another thing that I do. To go from 1 to 2, I write here A. And to go from 2 to 1, I also write A. So there is a prefactor, which is symmetric under the transition 1, 2, you see? And for 3, 1, there is a C, the same C that you see for 1, 3. So there is a symmetric prefactor, which does not change, which does not take into account whether you go from 1 to 2 or from 2 to 1. And there is an antisymmetric factor, which is related to the work you're doing to do that. This is the entropy flux. I'm not speaking about KBT here. And the same thing, we have a B here, which is the symmetric prefactor for 2, 3, and 3, 2. Now, I hope you remember, or you can see, or you can understand that for epsilon equal to 0, we have a detailed balance dynamics. It's time reversible. Going clockwise or counterclockwise doesn't matter. For epsilon equal to 0, in fact, you will find that the ABC is irrelevant. All states will be equally plausible. It doesn't matter what ABC you choose. If epsilon is equal to 0, they are equally plausible. If epsilon is not equal to 0, then they are no longer equally plausible. So here you have the plausibility, the probability of the states as a function of epsilon. You see, the probability can be very different. But that's not the only thing. What I'm saying here in this plot, or in this figure, is that in fact, by changing, for example, the B, you fix A and C to be equal to 1, for example, or you change, you take A equal to 1 and you take C equal to B, and you change B, you can go from you can go from, for B small, where say the state 2 is the most plausible, to a state where 3 becomes most plausible and where 1 becomes most plausible. In other words, you can steer, you can start to steer with time symmetric reactivities instead of steering with potentials or electric fields. You're steering with kinetic factors which are time symmetric. So that's the very simple example, probably well known, how the frenzy, here somehow not explicit in the formulas, how the frenzy is determining from the moment you're very far from equilibrium. I mean, this only works for epsilon far from equilibrium, how you can this make a population inversion. So before you could have that, okay, I can make it more difficult. You could have a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution and the typical Boltzmann weights and occupations. And by adding non-equilibrium, you can steer it so that you get a population inversion, so that, for example, the high temperature states also become the more plausible and no longer the low temperature states. Okay, so that is an example. The same thing happens, in fact, for current selection. Current selection is, of course, something which is important. I think I don't have time to explain that, but say if you want to understand the direction of certain molecular motors, this direction, whether it goes forward or backwards, so like in kinesin or myosin, this is not determined thermodynamically. It is determined frenetically, because on terms of entropy fluxes, you pay the same amount of entropy to go forward or backward. It is the kinetics, and in particular, if you want to go very quantitative, the frenzy that will select the current, and in the, here it would just be the direction of the molecular motor. Okay, I think I have to go on to go to conclusion here, and I will just to conclude, I will go back to the Landauer-Bennett quote, which was speaking about, you know, you remember comparing states, how you do that. What determines now for population selection, I'm not speaking about current selection now, what determines the probability of a condition? The point is that in contrast with equilibrium, where the probability of a condition is related to the entropy, to the free energy or the Gibbs free energy, in other words, to a phase space volume, here, far from equilibrium, it will be the accessibility, which plays the big role, and the lifetime and accessibility, or of course, this frenetic aspect that I heuristically was relating to the boundary between phase space volumes. So what is an accessibility? Well, an accessibility, we can give it mathematically in a moment, but accessibility is basically telling you, if you have a macroscopic condition, how easy it is to get there. And that means from other conditions. It tells you, it makes quantitative by following all kinds of paths from other conditions, and you look at the cost you have to pay to go to that condition, you get an accessibility estimate. And that accessibility enters in the probability of that condition. That is obviously not present in equilibrium. It's unheard of in equilibrium. And another thing which plays in the condition is the lifetime. It means if you're sitting in the condition, how easy it is to escape. What's the escape rate? Which is again a crucial thing for the probability of a condition. And here, everything related to jamming and localization is extremely important. If you have kinetic constraints, they are basically invisible for phase space volume. But of course, kinetically, far from equilibrium, they become important. So the lifetime is somehow related to the accessibility of the outside world, and the accessibility is the related to the accessibility to go from outside to inside. So it's like two times. It's to go from inside to outside. That's the lifetime, escape rate in a way. And the accessibility is to go from outside to inside. And these things can be made specific, precise, quantitatively, far from equilibrium. And I don't think I have time to formulate it even in the simplest case for Markov jump processes. Maybe just flash some formulas here. So if you remember the KXY, in my three-state model, that was the transition rate to go from X to Y. So if I sum over all Y, this is like the escape rate from X. So the logarithmic escape rate that we can call, well, if you take the exponential of epsilon gamma, that is like a lifetime. You can imagine it's like the inverse of an escape rate. But there is also an accessibility we have to speak about, and the accessibility is related to the fact that if you are in a condition, there is always a preferred successor. Now, if you don't take the preferred successor, you have to pay. And there is a cost which is related to a diminished escape rate from each condition. And so if you look at the diminishment of the escape rate as you want to approach X, you make mathematically, you construct an accessibility function. And the stationary distribution is then far from equilibrium in a mathematical expansion where epsilon is very big, given by the lifetime, which is this related to this gamma, and this cost to reach that state, which is the accessibility. Let me not go back to Boltzmann picture, but let me, it's a pity I don't have my iPad here because I could give you a simple example of that. To understand why you care. I mean, why would you like to have such a, how can you use this instead of maybe illustrating it? Well, think about the following question, and this is the last thing I will say. Think about the question that started with perceptron classification problem, neural networks, machine learning, deep learning. They are all original. They are all originating from very simple ideas in statistical mechanics. Equilibrium statistical mechanics is really the revolution which has given rise to machine learning and what have you. The same ideas as in neural networks, Hopfield model, etc. But what is the basic point? The basic point is that you make a potential, you try to learn, you let the system learn a potential where the various minima of the potential correspond to patterns that you want to recognize. And then there is a dynamics which is a gradient, like in my toboggan that I had in the beginning. There is a gradient dynamics that takes you, and that's called recognizing. You fall into these wells, you fall towards the local minima, and that's called recognition. So even if you start with the blurred picture of a cat, as you fall into the local minimum called cat, you recognize the cat. That's the kind of basic idea behind machine learning and neural networks, where you're making a gradient descent based on a cost function, which is mostly you can describe in terms of a potential for which you're defining a gradient response, gradient relaxation. Here, far from equilibrium, you get another completely different strategy, which is probably the strategy that we humans use in our brains. I mean, I cannot believe that my recognition and my brain working is based on free energy minimization or based on landscapes in free energy. Rather, I would hope that my brain works far from equilibrium. And to understand recognition, it's a matter of understanding how to make certain conditions very plausible. So we want to understand how we can make a condition plausible without using a potential. So we are not going to do it thermodynamically like they do in neural networks. We want to do it kinetically. Well, how you do it? Just by lifetime and accessibility. If you're able to make accessibilities and lifetimes big, you get it. Accessibility, that's related basically to the HEP rule, that you have to make it, the dynamical way to get this condition has to be good enough. But you do not touch entropies, you do not touch thermodynamic potentials in this strategy. You only will touch kinetic aspects, which will be enough for far from equilibrium brains to make conditions recognizable. Okay, I think I'm sorry for not saying everything I wanted to say, but I think I want to stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the nice talk. So I think we have some minutes for questions. So if anybody has a question, please raise the hand. Okay, Marcin has a question, please go on, unmute yourself.
I have a question. Once you split action into symmetric and anti-symmetric part with respect to time reversal, does it matter that when the perturbation which drives system out of equilibrium breaks the time reversal symmetry or not? I mean, because one can think.
I mean, the point is that you're in. It could be that you're not breaking it. It could be that you go from equilibrium to equilibrium. That's possible. But usually we consider this formalism for either time-dependent perturbations or for going to a new steady state, which is really outside equilibrium. And in that sense, it will make a driving, will break the time reversal symmetry.
Always, always, yes.
Yeah, but you see, I mean, of course, yeah, always, 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 yes.
Okay.
It's somehow related to the second law, what I'm saying.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question?
Okay, maybe I, first of all, thank you very much for the great talk, because it was really something I didn't know about this phronesi before, which is probably shame on me, because we are doing with non-equilibrium systems, but anyway, we are mostly working on non-equilibrium phase transitions, and I was wondering, are people using this framework to describe somehow, because there is a big debate if we can really use this methodology from equilibrium phase transition.
Yes, so that's of course an extremely interesting topic, is to understand whether the phenomenology of phase transition equilibrium, and together with criticality and universality, whether that is stable with respect to non-equilibrium, or whether in non-equilibrium new phase transitions appear, even which are unseen in equilibrium. That's an extremely exciting and relevant topic. What I am talking about is much simpler. Phase transitions do not enter here at all. They do not play really a big role at all here. in fact, I'm not even mentioning them. So this, all what I'm saying here is much more related to like the Gibbs formalism. You know, if you speak about the Gibbs formalism, you do not necessarily need to speak about phase transitions.
Sure.
It's more like how you compute specific heats, how you do linear response theory, how you do statistical forces, you know, like in the introductory level equilibrium statistical mechanics.
I understand.
Then you go to the second class, which is phase transitions, and this talk, I have not spoken about that.
Oh yeah, yeah, I understood this. What I'm questioning is if people are using this framework to somehow approach phase transitions.
Yeah, not yet sufficiently.
Not yet.
Except that, of course, here and there you have seen that. I mean, I have seen that in various places. One place where you can see that is in what sense, for example, the hypothesis of MacLennan, and in particular local equilibrium hypothesis, stands the presence of phase transitions.
Okay.
You know, for derivation of higher dynamic equations, often you're using a local equilibrium assumption. And one of the issues is whether at phase transitions, one can use this MacLennan formalism to discuss also near phase transitions, that because you see in the MacLennan formalism you already get long range correlations, and it's not so clear whether this will entangle itself with the long range correlations you get at criticality. So that's one place where you see that. Another place is in a discussion of transport coefficients, if you speak about heat conductivity, but that's already true close to equilibrium. Latent heat and other things, specific heat, was the behavior at phase transitions. So this is about kinetics of phase transitions. That's, of course, an old topic. But in this kind of what I would call Gibbs formalism approach, phase transitions are far too difficult to incorporate here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you. But anyway, we have to look at this closer because it seems to be really...
It's a bit of a mathematical kind of formalism for understanding structural questions.
My PhD students, they're all mathematicians, so...
Okay. I'm not saying it's mathematics, because, you know, for example, to understand that the antisymmetric part of this action is the entropy flux, that's not mathematics, that's physics.
Okay, since we are a little bit over time, so I would basically declare officially over the seminar, and I will stop the recording. But if the audience still have like some questions and wants to discuss with the speaker for a few minutes more, so there will stay open.
I can stay a little bit longer. It's just a pity that I don't have